Where did the leaders of the Adventist Church stand on the issue of race when compared with their white counterparts from the 1860s to the turn of the century around 1900?
You're asking the pioneers of the Seventh-day Adventist Church?
Of the Seventh-day Adventist Church. When we compare them with the individuals who helped bring about the end of slavery, like those individuals I mentioned, Lyman Beecher, Charles G. Finney, those ardent abolitionists, where did our pioneers stand on the issue when we compare them with those abolitionists of the 19th century?
Sure. Well, the Millerite movement effectively began when William Miller began preaching in 1831, preaching the soon advent of Jesus Christ. It effectively ended on the last disappointment, which was October 22, 1844. Our pioneers, the three founders of the church, James and Ellen White and Joseph Bates, were of course Millerites. From 1845 to 1863, May 20, 21, 1863, when the Seventh-day Adventist Church was officially incorporated and founded, the term Sabbatarian Adventists was used. And Sabbatarian Adventists were a loosely connected network of believers in the Midwest and Northeastern United States who believed in things like the seven-day Sabbath, the non-immortality of the soul, the high priestly ministry of Jesus Christ. Now, our pioneers who were a part of the Millerite movement, James White, Joseph Bates, they were very strong abolitionists, and they were anti-slavery. In fact, it's said that the abolitionist movement was begun in Joshua V. Himes' church in Philadelphia. Now, of course, Joshua V. Himes was William Miller's main PR man, and I think that he was one of the main catalysts for making Millerism successful and known and broadcasting it. If Joshua Himes was alive today, he'd probably be on Twitter and Facebook because he knew how to utilize media and spread the message. But Joseph Bates, as I say, was a strong abolitionist. He was a part of the abolitionist society. He was a very outspoken anti-slavery proponent. And when he accepted the soon coming of Jesus Christ, he desisted his abolitionist and anti-slavery agitation because he considered the second coming to be, quote, the fountainhead of all reforms. So in other words, when Jesus comes, he will end slavery. You know, he will get rid of tobacco. You know, whatever rights he was crusading for, Jesus' coming would address that. And so this is kind of a shift in the thinking where they thought this evil institution of chattel slavery is so heinous that only Jesus' second coming will end it. Now, when Jesus didn't come on October 22, 1844, our pioneers, in their writings, in their sermons, you saw a shift in their thinking, where now that they realized that Jesus was in the most holy place of the heavenly sanctuary, and that they had to preach the gospel to the entire world, that maybe slavery could end before Jesus came, because they had to reach the black American slaves, and how could you reach them with the infrastructure of slavery in place? It was against the law in many states to teach slaves how to read.
That's right.
So they can't get the gospel this way. But they came upon the realization that everyone had to have the gospel. And as wartime approached, they became very strident and vocal and outspoken in the publications against slavery. In fact, John Andrews, John Loughborough, Uriah Smith identified the United States as an eschatological villain of Revelation 13, the lamb-like beast who speaks as a dragon. They identified America as that dragon-like beast because of chattel slavery. They said, look, you can't get more dragonish, more beastly than this, than enforcing people slavery, it was a lot of things, but it was religious bondage. They did not have religious liberty. They did not have religious freedom. The slaves did not. They could not take the seventh day off. And so they saw America as speaking as the dragon through slavery and secondarily through their treatment of Native Americans. And so the Seventh-day Adventist Church, so much of what we believe about the end times is based on who we believe America to be. And that was really come upon through the way that blacks were treated and by our early pioneers. So they were extremely outspoken against slavery. And I mean, I give them, scale of 1 to 10, I mean, I give them a 10. When you read the Adventist Review from 1850 to the end of slavery, 1865, there are endless articles against, condemning slavery.